Okay. Who's on this wheelbarrow? Say your name loud and clear.
Nathan. Ray.
Very good. And the little dog's name?
Ray.
Ray, okay. We're coming closer and closer. These are my grandchildren, and my name is Stephen Pratt. And I'm glad to be here with my grandchildren. We're working in the garden. We're getting ready to haul manure. About a month ago, on April the 1st, my dad died. He would be these little children's great-grandfather. He died of old age. He was 97. And he used to record in his journal every day, kept a journal for most of his life. He would record exactly what he did every day. When I was a little fellow, about the age of these two right here, he had a farm and lots of horses and animals because they farmed with horses. Well, these young'uns are going to get this wheelbarrow full without my help. I can't even find my shovel. Anyway, the farm we had only horses, horsepower. And in his journal, he would write down every day, day after day during the winter, hauled manure. The next day, the same entry, hauled manure. just like we're doing now, huh? Yep. He was one of those grand old people that we would call the salt of the earth. He raised six children out there in that farm up in the state of Washington, Cashmere, Washington. Haul manure. Well, these little ones, they're going to grow up. Probably they won't have to haul much manure except to help their grandpa unless they like to work their own garden. Do you think you'll want a garden when you get older?
Heck yeah.
Yeah, do you think you'll want one, Raina? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you probably have to haul manure too. The message that we're going to introduce with this little video is the series known as Liberty and Learning. And we did this series for the most part at the old historic opera house in Beaver, Utah. And we're going to present about seven lessons. And these lessons are lessons that I'm creating, Stephen Pratt's creating, for my posterity. And I did indeed a few years ago create one called To Ourselves and Our Posterity.
And I'm also doing work again, I can.
You're one of my posterity, little Raina, you sweetheart. And Nathan, you're part of my posterity and grandma's, and we're a family. But our great country of America is in trouble. And it's in trouble because some of the people haven't been vigilant. They haven't paid attention to the principles of liberty.
And so we...
No, not too good. You're right, Nathan. So we're going to create this video series called Liberty and Learning. And all of them but the one lesson comes from the old historic opera house in Beaver, Utah.
And I am going to do the work as good as I can.
You are. You surely are. Well, do you have any last messages you want to share with the camera to tell the people that are going to watch this something special? Any last messages? Come right over here close by me and tell me what your message is. Okay, your message?
I'm doing this as great as I can, and also, my mom doesn't have to do this all the time, because I'm doing this with my grandpa.
Okay, do you have any last messages before we start the movie? Turn around, face the camera. You have to talk right close to grandpa, because he has the microphone on. Okay, any messages?
No, not really. Just hope you have fun.
Okay, thank you, Nathan. Very good. Finish filling that up. We'll go dump it on the garden. I'm delighted to be here. I'm delighted to be here with my friend Logan. What a great, great privilege to hear this young man speak, 14 years old. His brother Jesse usually comes. Tomorrow night, Jesse and Logan both will participate with me down in Enoch. And we expect to have a grand experience together. They're going to present tomorrow night part of the slide presentation, Original Intent. And we have actually named that special lecture tomorrow night, The Constitution, Our Only Hope. And so tomorrow night we'll each take a segment of that lesson. I'm looking forward to being there. We are concluding the series in Beaver by going back to the first lesson. This is the first one we gave. Some of you weren't here. But those that were, when we recorded it, we got a lousy recording. We were overdriving the sound. And so please bear with me. We're going to present the same message we presented on the opening night, how and why to study history. Why do we care about John Paul Jones? Why do we care about the Bonhomie Richard and the Serapis? Who cares? One of my dear friends yesterday said, it doesn't matter. Let somebody else sort it out. As they got on their big truck to drive down to the big lake with their big boat. Let somebody else sort it out. Okay, we're here and we're going to sort it out. Why do we study history? Is there any value in knowing the past? And we're going to try and understand in this reasonably short lesson how history is presented in various ways. And sometimes history is presented in a way that will mislead us. And hopefully this will be clear as we progress. One of the people we can learn from is Thomas Paine. He's one of these great heroes of the past. He came to America. He was not too well off. He had some problems in his life. And one thing that he did was published a pamphlet. Oh, it's not a pamphlet. It's about the size of half a Reader's Digest, the thickness and the size of the print job of Common Sense. He opens with this statement, a long habit of not thinking a thing wrong gives it a superficial appearance of being right. Now, for a long time, Americans have had the habit of not thinking things are wrong when they are. And for 100 years, 150 years, 200 years, there have been false educational ideas circulated so prevalently, so frequently, that we all think they're right. As a nation, as a country, as a people, we have believed false teachings. It's time, it is time that we reviewed our past and try and sort out the myth from the truth and try to decide then with truth on our side, what should we do? Who can deny that we're in an awful situation in the country today? One of the enjoyable reading series, it's a whole series of books, there are 11 in the series, are these books by Richard Maybury. And in this particular one, it's the first one of the series, he gives us a warning. He says, you may find things about your history, if you get serious about it and really delve into it, you may find things that hurt, that are painful. And he calls this cognitive dissonance. Now that's just a big word for saying it's the truth that hurts. And it's explained in his chapter. It's worth reading. The emotional stress that occurs when a person encounters a fact or persuasive idea that disagrees with his or her model. Now I may say something tonight or in one of the lesson series that we presented in the last few weeks that disagrees with your model. So somebody will write me a letter and they'll say, you're wrong. Or they'll come up and say it personally, you know, face to face. You don't know what you're talking about. It hurts. I believe I have evidence to verify everything I present. I have evidence that would hold up in a credible group of good scholars. I do believe that. So if I present something that hurts, kindly, gently share with me your feelings and I will try to find the evidence to show you why I presented those ideas. It's the truth that hurts. Now, the price of freedom is eternal vigilance. That's an old saying from probably Thomas Jefferson. Books, books, books. Books are one of the keys. In fact, in my life, they are the key to learning. We go back to the old books, to the new books, and we try to decide which books to read. Not just any book, but which books should I read to enhance my understanding of the past? This is one that I found value in. The Basic Symbols of the American Political Tradition by two political science professors, Wilmore Kendall and George Carey. On page 19, they say, myth is used to manipulate society. On page 118, the Civil War derailment. It tells what happened during this conflict in the history of the country. Very, very misunderstood period. On page 10, they speak of the official literature. There is official literature written by what they call the court historians. Those are the people that write the popular party line. What do we want every American to believe? What myth should we promote? And they present the myth as if it's fact. But on page 85, they have the big question. What should we do? I get lots of people that ask this. What should we do if the sound quits? So on page 85, we come to the question, what shall we do? Now, I have people that come up to me, and one particular lady I'm thinking of, and she says, I like your lectures, but they're just too long. Why don't you just tell us what to do? I can't tell you what to do because we're different. What you do and what I do may be totally different. But the question, who and what are we as a people, is critical to you deciding and me to decide what to do. Who are we? Where did we come from? What is our heritage? We must determine that before we can answer, what shall we do? As we do that, we're studying what's called history. Now we can't study, really we can't study the past, because the past is gone. All we can study is the evidence of the past. And so when we study history, we're studying evidence. The definitions of history I found quite entertaining. One of the definitions from the dictionary is, history is an account of what has happened. Okay, think about that. Here's another one. History is the story accepted by the public. How do you like that one? That's the one the court historians write. That's the one you read in your local high school history book. Some of it's truth, some of it's fiction. It's the story accepted by the public. Here's another definition of history. Evidence accompanied by reason and debate. If we're studying the past, all we can study is the evidence left over from the past, and then we can talk about it. That's a study of history. This next definition comes from a history professor named Ralph Ryko. He asked his students, what is history? And one of the students responded, it's just one damn thing after the other. Or maybe it's all of the above. Now, something terrible is going on over the hill. Something really bad. What could it be? Well, maybe it's a hijacking. Yes, it could easily be a hijacking. You know, we hear about hijacking a lot nowadays. But this hijacking I'm going to tell you about this evening in this lesson is much more serious than hijacking an airplane and running into a tower and killing 3,000 people. It's much more serious than that. This is a hijacking of our history. Now, that's the name of an article in the Reader's Digest about 1995, Hijacking Our History. Good short summary of what's going on. It's the same thing that the professors were talking about, where myth is being used to manipulate people, where the court historians have written reports that contain some mythological nonsense. Mythical blather, I call it. Mythical blather. History claiming to be true, and it's just mythical blather. There's lots of it. This great hero of the past, a product of Utah, went on to be a great statesman around the world. Ambassador to Mexico, Undersecretary of State. This is back in the 1920s. He said, we are in the midst of the greatest propaganda campaign the world has ever known. A propaganda campaign? You mean everything we hear on the news and read in the newspapers? Not true? Well, if it's a propaganda campaign, you can be assured some of it is false. Now, I'm going to give you six examples showing propaganda versus the truth, or perhaps it's propaganda versus propaganda. Somehow we have to sort out, is it true or is it false, or are they both false? But when you see the examples, you'll know they're not both true. We're going to go first to the government printing office, 1927. Now, I like to read primary sources, and in this particular case, I went to great effort to read the original manual. I first read it in a book. That's a secondary source. And they told me about the government training manual. But the real test is if it is in the government training manual, not if some author said it is in the training manual. And so I called the BYU Special Collections Library and I ordered in this manual. Now, it took about 2 months. And then one day they called and said, the manual has arrived. Now, it was kind of interesting to me. I went up, I hadn't done anything quite like this before, and I went up to the Special Collections door, and the lady opened the door and let me in, and she gave me the manual, and then she unlocked a door into a reading room with no other exits. And she closed the door behind me and locked it so I couldn't get out without knocking. And then she stood by a window and watched me while I read. Wow. I was reading top secret information. I was reading this right here on page 92 in the 1927 government training manual. The government of the United States is not a democracy. Now I know why she locked me and she didn't want the word to get out. That's just the opposite of the nonsense that's taught in every school in the nation. This is not a democracy, but a republic, it said in the government training manual in 1927. It went on to say, what are the principal characteristics of a democracy? Demagogism, license, impulse, agitation, discontent, anarchy, chaos, and socialism. Huh? That's democracy? But, well, it was really interesting reading, 120 or 130 pages. It took about 2.5 hours, and that lady watched the whole time. She sat down occasionally, but she paid attention that I wasn't using the razor blade and slitting the pages and whatever else people do to steal rare books. Okay, that is an example from a primary source of what they were teaching the military in 1927. They were teaching the military of this country that they were not a democracy, that we are a republic. And a democracy is all sorts of bad things, and it is chaos and socialism. Now, 25 years later, that's the first part of this example. 25 years later, I read the Army Training Manual, and it says this. In 1952, when I was a 12-year-old boy going to elementary or grade school. Because the United States is a democracy, huh? The majority of the people decide how our government will be organized and run. The people do this by electing representatives, and these men and women then carry out the wishes of the people. Do you see any problem with this and the other explanation? Which one's closest to the truth? Is either of them true? They cannot both be true. I submit for your consideration, one of them has to be false. Well, let's try another example. That I call, and this I get this from Kendall and Carey's book. They said, that's the official literature. The official literature, that which is published and broadcast and is popular. It's the popular story nationwide. Now, example number two. Oh, dear. You remember cognitive dissonance? Okay, we're going to try one on you now, see if the pain is too severe here. I was invited a few months ago to speak to a group of scout leaders, and they wanted me to talk about citizenship in the nation, and they wanted me to explain from the manual some of the things there. They invited me because I was supposed to be a constitutional scholar. And one the evening before I was supposed to speak, they decided I ought to see what the manual has in it. And so the evening before the talk, they brought me this Boy Scout training manual. It didn't take very long until I started pasting in what I call red flags, you know, sticky tabs, a little sticky tab here and a sticky tab there. And pretty soon I had 18 sticky tabs in 35 pages. The whole manual's only 35 pages. What was I marking? I was marking those areas of history that were either false or completely misleading because of how they were presented. I will give you an example. On page 7, this is the second sentence in the book, the second sentence of text. The government the colonists established in the late 1700s has remained intact. Well, hasn't it? Don't we have the same government today that we had then? Oh, I see a few of you shaking your heads this way. Nobody's shaking their head in here this way, but if you did, you'd probably be out of order because this is the right direction to shake your head. let's take a look at this. Let's examine this. Now, obviously, there's no evil intent. Nobody intended to do anything wrong but help young men grow up loving America. Kind of like the Army Training Manual of 1952. That and this would go together very well, the official literature. Let's take a look at a contrasting publication. Robert Bork, he's a great scholar. He was nominated by President Ronald Reagan to be a justice of the High Court. When his nomination was made, he had to come before the Senate and he had to be interviewed. And during the interview, someone asked him, what would you do if you became the justice of the High Court? Oh, what would you do? Well, he says, I would follow the Constitution as it's written. Oh, that was the wrong thing to say. Oh, so the enemies of the Constitution immediately raised $12 million so they could have a campaign to see that man did not make it into the High Court. Because if he did, he was going to follow the Constitution. How absurd. We haven't followed the Constitution in the Supreme Court for over 100 years. Well, it would be terrible to start doing it now. And so they did all they could, and they successfully kept him from getting his appointment. He did not make it. But he's a great scholar and a great man. He wrote a book called Slouching Toward Gomorrah. And in 2003, he wrote The Afterword, a new edition. In The Afterword, he said, quoting another federal judge, he himself was a federal judge, quoting another federal judge, he said, "The Constitution is simply gone." Well, now, he doesn't mean the printed pages are gone. We all have a copy. You know, the Constitution's here. He didn't mean that. What did he mean? He means they don't follow it anymore. It's gone because they don't follow it. And he was specifically referring to the case of Lawrence versus Texas, where the state of Texas passed a law, and the law was to outlaw, make it illegal to have sodomy in the state of Texas, against the laws of the state of Texas. And the Supreme Court overruled it. And that's when he said, if that can happen, they can do it to anything. We don't have a constitution anymore. Well, that's not the first time they overruled, but it is an example. So, which one is closest to the truth? Is our form of government established by our founding fathers alive and well today? Or is our constitution simply gone? Example number three. This is a Utah history book. I think probably could still be in use, possibly. I was invited by the publisher to proofread this book for content. The author is a fine, respected citizen, much loved, good man, no evil intent. I don't think there's any evil intent in any of these examples I'm showing you. It's just bad history. But which one's bad? I'm going to give you two examples now, and you're going to have to, you know, one of those has got to be wrong. They can't both be right. He spends a couple of chapters on the period around when FDR was president. These are some of the points taken out of those pages. Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal brought relief to millions. On December the 7th, 1941, there was a surprise attack on Pearl Harbor. Franklin Delano Roosevelt's fireside chats kept the people informed of the war's progress. Franklin Roosevelt was a great man of peace. President Franklin Roosevelt died very suddenly. So, isn't that the story accepted by the public? Isn't that it? Yeah, that's what I've been taught from my youth. He was a great hero. He saved us from the Great Depression and on down the list of things that are right there, a man of peace and so forth. Here's another viewpoint from another author. That was written, by the way, in 1999. The author is Alan Stang. He's a very widely read published scholar, very widely read, national bestsellers multiple times. He's writing in newswithviews.com on February the 1st, 2008. He writes this, speaking about the same man, liar, swindler, thief, traitor, and mass murderer, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Huh? Which one of these guys is closest to the truth? Is it important to know? Oh, I'll just get my big boat and drive out to the lake and let someone else sort it out. Yes, yes. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. That's a billboard up here going to Victor Provo. You've probably all seen it. Some things are true whether you believe them or not. Remember back in Thomas Paine when he said we go through our whole lives thinking something's true and it's not? Well, a picture is worth 1,000 words. Now, that's an unusual picture. A picture is worth 1,000 words. Let's just take a look at that picture. There's 1,000 words of history there. Let that picture symbolize 1,000 words of history. Oh boy, what is it? Who even knows what it is? Okay, it's a printing press. Now, it just happens to be, I don't want to brag or anything, but I just happen to be a specialist in printing presses. A guru around the world. I've sold printing presses in Japan, and I sold covered wagons in Japan, Switzerland, Canada, Australia, old-fashioned printing presses. It's a delight with me. I just enjoy them. I understand old-fashioned printing presses. So if I were to read 1,000 words of history about printing history, I would be able to make an evaluation as to whether it's good or well and well written or bad, poorly written. I can do that. But let's suppose you're new to printing presses, which most of you are, probably all of you. Probably you don't understand much about that, barely could identify it as a press. Let's suppose that's the only printing history you read. That's the story accepted by the public. That's what that is right there. That is a hideous example of a printing press. It won't work. And here's why. Where this box is formed here, it's missing a major component called the carriage. Underneath the printing mechanism here, there's a great big table, and it has a slab of stone 3 inches thick. And on top of the slab of stone, it has an inch high layer of metal type. So you have an inch thick layer of lead, you have 3 inches of stone, plus the sand and the wood and the iron that hold this all together. And when he's done pulling this bar and printing, he has to slide this out onto something so it doesn't just fall on the floor. Well, that something isn't there. Now let's take another look at part of this press. See that arrow right there? That thingamajig right there is called, what isn't there is how I should say this. This is a screw and this is a pushing device, and he's pulling the bar and it's supposed to push down. And that little square box right there, that fits inside of a till. But the till is not there. Now the till converts rotary motion into linear motion. But there is no till. It won't work. There's no carriage, there's no till. But worse than that, look at this one. That's the screw. If you look close at that, you'll see it's all screwed up. That screw is backwards. If you pull the bar, you raise the platen instead of printing. Oh dear, it won't work. This is terrible history. Well, sad to say, this is how much of our history is written at this same level. You read it in the newspapers, you read it in textbooks, you see it in movies, and we think it's true, but it's not. Let's let this press represent the story accepted by the public. Let's let this carriage, the missing carriage, and the missing till represent a historical term called historical blackout. Now they're missing. Can we change the meaning of history if we take certain things out and we don't tell the whole story? Can we mislead somebody if we don't tell the whole story? We'll tell the truth as far as we tell it, but we just won't tell it all. Okay, that's called historical blackout. That's a history term. Now we've got this other problem. We've got this device that's just plain wrong. It's wrong. We have a name for that in history. It's called false propaganda. So we have historical blackout coupled with false propaganda, and when we put the two together, we have historical brainwashing. And it goes on every day, all around the world. Let's take an example here. We're going to look at this close up, and we're not going to try and teach you the whole story. I'm just going to give you a little example of how historical blackout can change our understanding of our system. The missing carriage. Let's let that missing carriage represent the gigantic faction of 1861. Now, unless you've heard my lessons before, most of you probably don't know what we're talking about. A gigantic faction? Many of us don't know what a faction is. But what happened in 1861 that was so dramatic, and how did a faction affect that? Well, there are thousands and tens of thousands of books about that faction, and they present both viewpoints, multiple viewpoints, and you're confronted with the problem of, I wonder who's telling the truth, if anyone. These are a few of the books I have carefully studied about that faction. There were 17 in that pile when I took the picture, and since then I've read about 9 more, carefully studying this period of history, the gigantic faction of 1861. It's like a puzzle. Every book adds another bit of color or a little detail to the puzzle, and you're slowly putting the picture together. Wow. Right? I don't want to elaborate because I'm reading two or three right now at the same time. I get so excited about it. I get three books out there and I start reading one. But this is what this guy said over here. And I read over there and I go back to the first one, back and forth. Wow, learning's fun. You enjoy learning, don't you? Sure. Here's another example from that stack. The American Union by James Spence, written in 1862. Great reading. It's good stuff. As he explains the gigantic faction of 1861. At the present day, that's in 1862. At the present day, we search in vain for one single name that may be termed that of a statesman. Politicians cover the land. Statesmen seem to have become extinct. He was having that problem in 1862. Politicians cover the land today, but statesmen seem to be extinct. Here's another great read. I'm working on this one again right now. I've read it carefully once and I'm doing it, cross-referencing into it. Abel Parker Upshur. These authors of the past are interesting characters. I love to learn about them. In 1863, his book was published. He died in 1844. He died when he was the Secretary of State of the United States. He'd gone through a long life of the legal profession, serving in various positions. He was Secretary of Navy, and then when Daniel Webster retired, Abel Parker Upshur became Secretary of State, so a high-ranking position. He was on one of the American military vessels, and they were shooting the big Bertha cannon off to some celebrate activity, and the cannon blew up, killing him and perhaps others. Okay, that was the end of him. But his book didn't end. I like the title, The True Nature. Now, if he's going to write The True Nature, that must mean he thinks there is a false nature. If there is a true nature, there will be a false nature and character of our federal government. A critical review of Joseph Story's commentaries on the Constitution. Now, Abel Parker Upshur is a highly skilled professional lawyer. He is criticizing some of the content of another highly skilled professional lawyer's books. There's a series of books called Commentaries on the Constitution. And Abel Parker Upshur says, Mr. Story is putting into his books the political feelings that he has, and he's passing them off as if they were part of the truth of American history. When they're really, in the viewpoint of Abel Parker Upshur, they're really mythical blather. Well, Joseph Story's books are considered today to be some of the greatest scholarly treatise ever done on the Constitution. Who's telling the truth? Which one of these lawyers is telling the truth, if either? Here's another great read. Now, this one's on the table over here. The Republic of Republics by Bernard Jannon Sage. Jannon Sage is another attorney. And he was the attorney for Jefferson Davis after the Civil War. Jefferson Davis was arrested and thrown into jail, rather violently abused, mistreated. And it was declared, we're going to hang you, Jeff Davis. We're going to hang you for treason. Now, that was the North that was going to hang Jefferson Davis because they knew he'd committed treason. Well, Bernard Jannon Sage just happened to be the attorney that was working on the case for and in behalf of defending Jefferson Davis. This is an aside from this lecture, but it's interesting history that most people have never heard. After they had mistreated Jefferson Davis for several months, the North acquired a lawyer, the highest paid, best professional they could find. And they said, you go prosecute and see this guy gets hung. Well, the lawyer looked at the case and he says, I quit. I won't take the case because if I do, you'll probably lose. Oh, well, we'll find another lawyer then. So the North found another lawyer, again, the highest paid, best professional person that they could locate. And he said the same thing. He looked at the situation and he says, don't take this to court, you'll probably lose. What do you mean? What am I saying? I'm saying that if those two lawyers were right and the North went to court and they lost the case against Jefferson Davis, the whole Civil War would have been fought illegally and the North were the bad guys. Oh, well, then they decided, well, let's see, what are we going to do about this? We better not go to court. Oh, we'll give him a pardon. So they went to Jefferson Davis in his dungeon there and they said, we pardon you. You're free to go. I don't want a pardon. I want my day in court. I want to go to court and prove that we were right and you were wrong. Oh, no, no, we're not going to court. So then a shrewd lawyer, these lawyers, they keep getting into the story here. He figured out, Why don't we just open the door and let him go? Yeah, that's what they did. They said, why, if we try him, that'll be double jeopardy because, you know, and then they figured out some goofy twisting of the law. They were going to have double jeopardy if they put him in trial, so they couldn't possibly have a trial. So they just opened the door after 2 years of holding him without charges. They just opened the door and let him go. That's history most people have never heard before. Well, he writes, Bernard Jan and Sage writes in 1876, and then he didn't publish it till 78 because the political climate was adverse. He published what he considered to be, the history of America for the previous 100 years. An excellent read. You have to be a serious scholar interested in learning, but there are a couple of copies on the table for serious scholars. Facts and Falsehoods Concerning the War on the South by George Edmonds. Now, George Edmonds was a woman, and her name was really Elizabeth Meriwether. But at that time in America, this was 1904, it wasn't good to have a woman's name on a history book because women aren't smart. We have to have a man's name so it looks like a smart person. Maybe even a lawyer wrote the book. This is the reason Elizabeth Meriwether chose the pen name of George Edmonds. She writes in her book, quoting from a Union officer who wrote in 1887, "The true story of the late war has not been told. It probably never will be told. It is not flattering to our people. Unpalatable truths seldom find their way into history." Well, that's a thought-provoking statement. A Union officer says the truth hasn't been told and it probably never will be because unpalatable truths seldom find their way into history. Now, we're giving examples. I didn't want to give you a whole story. That's part of the other part of our lesson series. Here's another example of blackout. Here we have the missing till. It's supposed to go around this square section and hold it from turning. The missing till that would hold and change rotary motion to linear motion. Let's take an example here. Let's look at the great gold heist of 1933. 700, that's 700 million ounces of gold were stolen. That's more gold than Porter Rockwell ever found on any stagecoach out here in the Utah desert. You know some of the great stories of Porter Rockwell of the past where he caught the bank robbers. 700 million ounces of gold. Would this be history of any value to the youth of America to know what the biggest gold robbery was in the whole country ever? And to know who did it and how? In fact, right today, who can doubt but that our economy is in a can of worms? The whole economy, with all this nonsense going on of creating money out of nothing, who can doubt that we're in trouble? This would be a key to beginning an understanding. The great gold heist. Here they are. They're stealing it right here. They're putting the gold in these boxes and putting it in a safe place where the thieves can maintain and monitor it. And on the radio coming down this evening, I was listening to a talk show. They were talking about our money supply. And one of the specialists says, "I wonder how much money or how much gold we have. Nobody seems to know if we have any more gold or not." You see, what the government did was they stole the gold from the American people and they put it in a safe place. But nobody knows, according to the radio talk show tonight, how much there might be somewhere. Well, who are these people? Well, they're just the workers. They're just the government workers that are carrying out orders from the higher-ups. Here's the higher-up. That's the number one gold heist thief. Now you know why that one word was on Alan Stang's list of descriptive words. He called this man a thief. That wasn't the only thing he stole, but that was one example. Oh, people will defend this vigorously. Oh, no, he had to do that. Why, by doing that, he stabilized the economy and soon got America back on its feet again. Why, if he hadn't? Come on now. What's the truth? Here's another example of a book that gives information on it, The Great Myths of the Great Depression. Here's a great read, What Has Government Done to Our Money? We're going to cover more of that in the second lesson this evening. Another great read, I really like this one. He talks about the great presidents. He says, the great presidents are not those pious humbugs who took our best men and sent them off to slaughter. The great presidents are the ones who followed the Constitution, like Millard Fillmore. I like that one because, you know, I'm right up there in Millard County and Fillmore is, you know, right next door. So I liked the Millard Fillmore example. He says the great presidents are the ones that followed the Constitution. They stayed home and minded their own business. Oh, we don't hear about those presidents. One great scholar, a truly great scholar, recently, just like, you know, 6 months ago, published a book called Recarving Rushmore. Huh? Recarving Rushmore. That hint to you what his book's about? It's about classifying presidents as to their greatness. And he goes through all of the presidents from George Washington through George W. Bush, and he classifies them based on this standard. What did they do to follow the Constitution according to its original intent? How do you like that standard? And when you use that as a standard, you get a different classification than what the court historians declare are the great presidents of the United States. Hamilton's blessing in the left book on the left compared or contrasted to Hamilton's curse in the book on the right is another example of two contending viewpoints. One claiming Hamilton was one of the greatest of all the founding fathers, and the other one claiming he was one of the worst of all the founding fathers, and they both lay out what they say is evidence. Which one's closest to the truth? Let's take the screw now. The screw. It's the one that's going backwards. It's wrong. It's false propaganda. Let's see if we can think, okay, the supreme fraud of 1945. Now, supreme means it's the biggest fraud. In fact, it might be the biggest fraud of the last 100 years. If not the last 100, or at least for sure for 1945, what could it possibly be? What's the biggest fraud perpetrated upon the people of America? Yeah. The Charter of the United Nations? Are you, Mr. Pratt, you got mixed up. That's the wrong slide. You pushed the wrong button. Push some other button. Let's talk about some other big fraud. I submit for your consideration that this is the biggest fraud, the supreme fraud of 1945. And again, that's a whole evening's lesson, a fascinating comparison between the Charter of the United Nations and our Charter of Liberty. And that comparison is done by Herb Titus, and you can see it on my website, or listen to it, or read it. It's available on the tapes that are disc that we hand out also. Herb Titus, two contrasting charters, as a great scholar compares. Who were the chief architects of the United Nations Charter? So you see, if I say this is a supreme fraud, and people say, oh no, that can't be. Why, down here at our local school, we praise the United Nations, and we have a special assembly every year, and we assign the students projects to honor this great organization that brings so much blessing to the world. Is there any evidence that that's maybe misconceived? Let's take a brief look. The Charter of the United Nations. I was listening to the radio about 20 years ago, and I have not forgotten it. It was George Bush Sr. speaking. He was just about ready to invade Kuwait. And if we invaded Kuwait, he said, we would be able then to start realizing the goals of the founders of the United Nations by invading Kuwait and other associated activities that would go with that. Now we can start enjoying the goals of the founders of the United Nations. We will be able to have the New World Order. He said that all on that same radio program 20 years ago. I'm like, huh? What am I hearing? I was a brand new student back then, Logan. I just barely started studying. Now, what did I hear my president say? Well, I asked myself the question then, who were the chief architects of the United Nations Charter? If we're now about to realize their goals, maybe we ought to know who they are. Is that a bad question? And what were their goals? Here's an example. This man right here is Alger Hiss. He's the first Secretary General of the United Nations. He is the man leading the convention in San Francisco. 3 years later, he was exposed as what? A communist. He was our top diplomat from the United States. He was accompanied by 17 other diplomats who were also later exposed as being of the same political persuasion. These men are the architects of the United Nations Charter. Oh, but they're not alone. Other countries sent their architects also to draft the charter. Who is this?
That's Joseph Stalin.
Now, if the Guinness Book of World Records had a section for mass murderers, he would win. Biggest mass murderer in the history of the world, and perhaps close to Mao Tse-tung. Oh, Hitler wasn't even up in the running there. This is one bad honcho, one bad villain here. And he's sending over his diplomats, in the plural, to go to the convention in San Francisco to help draft the United Nations Charter. I'm talking about the same charter that's applauded all over the United States as a wonderful charter. These are the men that wrote it. Well, who is this man? The head honcho from the Soviet Union, the top henchman of Joseph Stalin. His name is V.M. Molotov. Huh. These are the authors, plus more just like them. Huh. I wonder what they wrote. Peace and prosperity and love and fellowship for humankind? Is that what's in the charter? Don't count on it. So the two contrasting charters, the supreme fraud of 1945, when you get down to the bottom line, this charter is based on rule of force. And this charter of liberty is based on the rule of the laws of nature and of nature's God. Wow, what a contrast. Well, here's another press picture. It's an improvement. Being a press guru, you know, I look at these pictures with enthusiasm. We've built 46 presses, and we've shipped presses all around, like I say, around the world, literally. This one right here has some beautiful features. Notice this thing is the carriage that was missing on the previous press. The missing till is right here. Oh, how wonderful. Now we can convert rotary motion into linear motion. We can drag this great big heavy stone and all that lead type out on this lovely table out here called the carriage. But there's just one thing wrong. One thing wrong. See this? Well, that's the carriage right there. That's not wrong. That's right. And the till is right there. That's right. That's the right till. It's this problem right here. If you look really close at that, you'll see it's a little sweet angel. A little sweet cherub hiding the screw. But you see what's wrong with the screw again? It's screwed backwards. These artists, you know, you just can't trust an artist. Anyway, so we have another example of a printing press screw that's screwed up instead of down. This is false propaganda, historical whitewashing. Warning, this should be on all history. When studying history, look for the cherub in front of the screw. You know, on the front of every history book. Now, the United Nations Reform Act of 2005, House Resolution 2745, when it was presented to Congress, these claims were made. The lofty goals of the United Nations as reported by Tom DeLay. Now, this is before Congress, trying to persuade 434 congressmen that the United Nations should receive more funding and more support from the United States. He said, why the United Nations prevents wars, it protects human rights, and it advances the cause of human freedom. Oh, well, that's what it does. Let's all go in our camper and go fishing and let somebody else sort it out. I submit for your consideration, those are not the goals of the United Nations. Ask yourself this. Are those the goals of Joseph Stalin and V.M. Molotov and the delegation from the Soviet Union? Are they the goals of the delegation from the United States, headed by communist Alger Hiss with 17 other communists in support? Are those their goals? I can submit for your consideration, those are not their goals. Let's try some others here. Oh, but first, this is the rest picture. This is the best printing press picture I've ever seen. Everything in it is correct. Even the dog on the floor. All of these parts on the floor are drawn down there and they're lettered F, A, B, C. And then up here, the artist has drawn all the parts showing where they fit. Wow, that's good. I call this the bare naked truth. It's clear. It's straightforward. And this is the symbol for the bare naked truth. Straight out of Hans Christian Andersen's fairy tale book. The emperor has no clothes, but I call it the empire has no clothes when we relate it to history. That's my symbol for the truth. Example number 4. Oh, these two books. Excellent reads, both of them. On the left, we have Roosevelt's Road to Russia by George N. Crocker, written in 1959. On the right, we have FDR and the Creation of the United Nations, written in 1997 by Hoops and Brinkley. Both books take about two chapters to explain the Atlantic Charter. The Atlantic Charter was a very key part of the United Nations as the United Nations was developing. Now, we went through this in a previous lesson, the Atlantic Charter. If you read it from George Crocker, you're going to get a completely different perspective than if you read it from Hoops and Brinkley. Which one's closest to the truth? Example 5. This American history book, 1,080 pages, weighs 5.3 pounds. No shortage of paper when they printed that one. This is an example of a 500-page book that explains what they in here are at that time unable to explain. This book was printed in 2000. This book came out in the 90s, actually earlier than that, and then was reprinted. Sometimes when historians write, they don't have all of the evidence. And they'll write their history with the evidence that's available. And so when this book was written, based on the evidence available, they made comments about Pearl Harbor. The other book had more evidence. In fact, the author spent 17 years of his life digging out the evidence for this book. Good, sound historical evidence, right out of the libraries of the federal government. And he puts the Xerox pages in the book to show you the secret documents that have been recently released through the Freedom of Information Act. In the book on the left, it says, the question of Pearl Harbor. Revisionists are unable to produce any direct evidence of Roosevelt's knowledge of the planned attack. Now, he's speaking here of revisionist historians. I used to think a revisionist historian was a bad guy writing something bad about some truth of the past. Some of you probably have got some similar notion of that. Like a revisionist historian is the one that says, why, we now know that Thomas Jefferson had illegitimate children with his slave Sally. That's all proven fact because of DNA. Don't we all know that? You ever hear anything like that? Did you hear the next year, a year later, when the rebuttal came out and the company that had published the false information retracted it and said it was wrong? Did you hear that part of the story? No, we didn't hear that part. No, that was in little tiny print in some magazine nobody reads. So the DNA thing was a hoax. It was mythical nonsense. It was blather. Probably, I suggest, possibly came out in a timely manner to make William Jefferson Clinton not look so guilty. Possibly. Okay, what about Pearl Harbor? Do we have the facts? Did this book have them? No, they didn't. They wrote the book in 1991, the edition I'm reading from, but the facts were not brought out until 2000. The evidence. In 2001, I'm summarizing here, this book contains direct evidence of FDR's involvement and foreknowledge of the attack on Pearl Harbor. Oh, there's another word from the list that Alan Stang gave us. Foreknowledge and didn't do anything to stop it. Alan Stang used a very harsh word to describe this kind of behavior. Example number 6. Please go to my red suitcase, Paul, and unzip the cover. You did this the first time we presented this lesson. There are two books in there. No, the little one. That top front cover. No, the top. We want these two books out of there. This is the sixth and last example of how and why we study history and the challenge we have as students to try and discern what's true and what's myth. We're looking here at William Holmes McGuffey, his second grade reader, and printed in original 1879 and still in use in 1920. Now we're going to take the book on the right first. This is a reader made for second grade students. This is the official literature. I'm going to read one story out of here. You could read any story and get the same kind of examples. I'm going to go to the story. I believe we have it on the next slide. And it will be Rachel's birthday party. Okay, this is to teach the children in the second grade reading, writing, spelling, punctuation, grammar, English. Rachel had planned her party since last Friday. Her friends arrived early. She greeted each one with a broad smile. She received her presents at the door. She liked the African plant her best friend gave her. Then they all sat down. Rachel's father was going to entertain them. He did magic tricks. He forced a rabbit to stand up. Then he made Rachel's mother float in the air. She was level with the top of the table. She remained in the air a whole minute. Everyone had a good time. Wouldn't you just be enthused about your children going to school and reading that kind of literature? This is a genuine Utah, probably out of date now, but they keep replacing them with the same kind of mythical blather, trivia, nonsense, entertainment. I want to read the example out of an earlier book of children's literature. This story is called Henry the Bootblack. My father went to school in a one-room schoolhouse, and this was the book he learned to read from. Not this physical book here, but one just like it. McGuffey's Readers. Wow. Every story in McGuffey is similar to the one I'm about to read. Henry was a kind, good boy. His father was dead, and his mother was very poor. He had a little sister about 2 years old. He wanted to help his mother, for she could not always earn enough to buy food for the little family. One day, a man gave him a dollar for finding a pocketbook which he had lost. Henry might have kept all the money, for no one saw him when he found it, but his mother had taught him to be honest and never to keep what did not belong to him. With the dollar, he bought a box, three brushes, and some blacking. He then went to the corner of the street, and he said to everyone whose boots did not look nice, "Black your boots, sir, please." He was so polite that gentlemen soon began to notice him and to let him black their boots. The first day he brought home 50 cents, which he gave to his mother to buy food. When he gave her the money, she said as she dropped a tear of joy, "You are a dear good boy, Henry. I did not know how I could earn enough to buy bread. But now I think we can manage to get along quite well." You know how you felt. You know how you felt. What should we do? Let's take a 10-minute rest, and then we'll come back and continue explaining. 10 minutes of rest.